I'm always amazed at how the Lord is doing things, even when we are not trying to assist Him in doing things. I want to read for you something that we just sang. And I want you to remember these words as you hear this sermon this morning. That you just sang these words. Maybe you didn't sing them, but maybe you were reading them, whatever. But you just, these words just came out of you. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. You know, sometimes it's easy to sing words that don't apply to me. Or I'm just singing them because I'm just singing them. I surrender my life. If I was to give you a piece of paper today and have you write down what does it mean for you to surrender your life, what would you write down? I surrender this piece of my life? Or this piece of my life? Or this piece of my life? Is it possible for us to surrender only some of us? Only part of us? I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. The title of today's sermon is simply One More Soul, and you guys have heard me preach One More Soul sermons many times, whether it's been just one more soul or another soul or whatever. But as we begin the new year, I wanted to bring us to one more soul. And I want to point out for us today some scriptures that I believe are important for us as modern day believers to get a hold of, to practice in our life, to hang on to. But I think it boils down to just what we just sang. I surrender my life, all of my life, to Jesus. To surrender everything. How many of you remember Paul Harvey? If you're old enough to remember Paul Harvey, raise your hand. All you kids are not raising your hands. You have no idea who Paul Harvey is. For those old folks in the room, we used to hear Paul Harvey every day on the radio. Because we didn't have 100 video games to be playing or 1,000 computers to be working on. We actually listened to the radio. Somebody say amen. That's how old we are. Every day at noon, Paul Harvey was on the radio and everybody listened to Paul Harvey on the radio. I remember people gathering around the radio when Paul Harvey would come on just to hear what Paul Harvey had to say. Somebody say amen. Did you know that Paul Harvey was a Christian? Did you know that Paul Harvey was an amazingly strong, believing, follower, Christian believer? In 1965, Paul Harvey put out a radio message that shook the world. We're going to listen to that radio message dated 1965. And as you hear that message this morning, I invite you to ask yourself this question. Is this still important for us to hear today?
If I were the devil, if I were the devil, If I were the Prince of Darkness, I'd want to engulf the whole world in darkness, and I'd have a third of its real estate and four-fifths of its population, but I wouldn't be happy until I had seized the ripest apple on the tree. Thee. So I'd set about however necessary to take over the United States. I'd subvert the churches first. I'd begin with a campaign of whispers. With the wisdom of a serpent, I would whisper to you as I whispered to Eve. Do as you please. To the young, I would whisper that the Bible is a myth. I would convince them that man created God instead of the other way around. I would confide that what's bad is good and what's good is square. And the old, I would teach to pray after me, our Father, which art in Washington. And then I'd get organized. I'd educate authors in how to make lurid literature exciting so that anything else would appear dull and uninteresting. I'd threaten TV with dirtier movies and vice versa. I'd peddle narcotics to whom I could. I'd sell alcohol to ladies and gentlemen of distinction. I'd tranquilize the rest with pills. If I were the devil, I'd soon have families at war with themselves, churches at war with themselves, and nations at war with themselves, until each in its turn was consumed. And with promises of higher ratings, I'd have mesmerizing media fanning the flames. If I were the devil, I would encourage schools to refine young intellects, but neglect to discipline emotions. Just let those run wild. Until before you knew it, you'd have to have drug-sniffing dogs and metal detectors at every schoolhouse door. Within a decade, I'd have prisons overflowing. I'd have judges promoting pornography. Soon I could evict God from the courthouse, then from the schoolhouse, and then from the houses of Congress. And in his own churches, I would substitute psychology for religion and deify science. I would lure priests and pastors into misusing boys and girls and church money. If I were the devil, I'd make the symbol of Easter an egg and the symbol of Christmas a bottle. If I were the devil, I'd take from those who have and give to those who wanted until I had killed the incentive of the ambitious. And what'll you bet? I couldn't get whole states to promote gambling as the way to get rich. I would caution against extremes in hard work, in patriotism, in moral conduct. I would convince the young that marriage is old-fashioned, that swinging is more fun, that what you see on TV is the way to be. And thus I could undress you in public, and I could lure you into bed with diseases for which there is no cure. In other words, if I were the devil, I'd just keep right on doing what he's doing.
Paul Harvey. Good day.
You think Paul Harvey knew he was speaking prophetically? How many of those things today do we see that are absolutely true in our culture? In fact, is there none that aren't true right now? Don't all of those things mirror the very image of what our culture has become in the United States of America? So we can easily become discouraged by that. We can easily look at that and say that there is no hope. But I want to submit to you this morning that there is hope. But the hope that we desire and the hope that we need does not lie in culture. It does not lie in the American lifestyle or the American dream. It does not lie in the accumulation of more money and more things. It does not lie in any of those things. Because all of those things, and I use the word all there, because I believe the word all is true, all of those things lead us away from the Lord. not towards the Lord. We sit here today in our awesome building that the Lord has given to us to use for His kingdom. We sit here today grateful for grace, singing words like, I surrender my life, but I don't really do that. Or I owe all to You, but I don't really give Him everything. And we become the vehicle from which those things continue to happen. We become part of that process for so many people around us. Because the Lord has asked us to be a light. The Lord has asked us to be a city on a hill. The most powerful thing for me in that whole scenario is where He talks, I would get churches to be at war with themselves. Somebody say amen. As a church, are we at war with ourselves? Is part of the reason that we don't do the things we're supposed to be doing because we can't get past us? Are we a part of the problem or are we part of the cure? In 2017, are we going to be a light on a hill? Or are we going to be just another church doing the same thing? Still fighting amongst ourselves? Still struggling amongst ourselves? Still unable to get out of the way so that Jesus can use us? The very essence of the gospel is really one more soul. And my hope today is to prove to you today that there is a real thing, something we can do, every one of us can be involved in, every one of us can participate in, that will allow us to become a city on a hill. But for this to take place, we have to make a decision. The decision is whether we're going to be a church like all the other churches, or we're going to be something different. Now, I admit to you, it's more comfortable for us to be a church like all the other churches. Somebody say amen. It's a lot easier to do that, isn't it? To just go with the flow. But is that what our culture needs? Is that what our cities need? Is that what our families need? Turn with me in Luke chapter 15 this morning. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to encourage you to do something from this point on. I'm going to ask you to do me a really big favor. Starting this Sunday, from this Sunday, please bring your Bible every Sunday to church. Stop relying on this video screen for your text. Bring your Bible and open it. Please. Please. So that you have something to take home with you from what God has said to you today. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Understand, the religious people are mad because Jesus is trying to reach people who need to be reached. Somebody say amen. If you're frustrated at times here at Cornerstone because you think we're doing things in ways that we're not supposed to be doing them, or you think that we're trying to reach out to people and you would think that we would do something else, I want you to understand, you're in the wrong place. Suppose one of you had 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 persons who do not need to repent. Let's bring that down to practical terms here today. If Jesus was in this room, he probably wouldn't even be here. Jesus would probably be out there somewhere. Now we know that he is here in his spirit. But if Jesus was walking the earth today, would he be in the church? Or would he be out with the sinners? I submit to you that he would be spending far more time out than he would be in. And he tells us that in heaven, there is more rejoicing over one sinner who repents than over 99 who do not need to repent. One more soul. Jesus clearly brings to us the very principle of why he was even here, which we're going to get to in just a minute. Verses 8 through 10. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of angel of God over one sinner who repents. Now, will you agree with me this morning, as we move from this point forward, that what we just heard from Paul Harvey on the screen is absolutely evident in every part of our world today? Will you agree with me that that is true? If that is true, then I ask you, what are we going to do? If those are our family members, what are we going to do? If those are our co-workers, what are we going to do? Nothing? Are we going to do nothing? Let me rephrase that. What would Jesus do? And we've all heard that term, and we've all wore those bracelets, WWJD. And we wear them with pride, and we have those t-shirts, and we have all the things. But I wonder how much of it actually applies. It's cool to wear the stuff. It's cool to sing the song. It feels good. But does it apply? Do I actually live that? The part that's really interesting too is about the whole how he speaks about how the devil will whisper and get people confused. I'm telling you, the devil is constantly trying to keep us from being who we're supposed to be, both personally and corporately. He is constantly whispering, trying to keep us from being what God wants us to be. He is constantly speaking into your ear, trying to get you off track, trying to keep you and your family from living in freedom, trying to keep you from being a real believer, trying to keep you in jail, because it looks like what everybody else is doing, so it must be okay. He's doing that in every church that wants to be a Bible-believing church. He's trying to speak into every church that wants to have a Bible-believing foundation and wants to live out the gospel of Jesus Christ. He is trying to get that church at war with themselves and off track. Moving away from their purpose instead of towards their purpose. So to really bring that home today, I'm going to give you some quotes, some what I've entitled today, Important Jesus Quotes. And I'm going to ask you, if you have your Bible, to underline these in your Bible. I'm kind of in teaching mode more than preaching mode today, so I'm going to ask you to really look at these things up in your Bible and spend some time with these things. First one is Luke chapter 19, verse 10. This is Jesus speaking. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Jesus did not come that we would have great churches or great church. Jesus came to seek and save the lost. That was His sole purpose in coming. The reason that Father God put Him into Mary's womb and had Him born into Israel. To seek and save the lost. It's the very purpose that Jesus came to this world. If you can agree with that, just nod your head. That's what Jesus came to do, right? Okay, let's go on to John chapter 5, verse 19. Again, Jesus is speaking. Very truly, He says, I tell you, the Son of Man could do nothing by Himself. He can only do what He sees His Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. In other words, Jesus came fulfilling the will of the Father. So Jesus came to seek and save the lost, which is the will of the Father. Somebody say amen. He saw His Father doing this, and so He came to this world to do what His Father was doing, seeking and saving the lost. That's why He came. That's also what the Father is doing all the time. The Father is constantly sending His Holy Spirit into this world to seek and save the lost. To speak into people's lives who are lost so that they will turn towards Jesus. Because He knows that their only hope in this world is Jesus. It is not the world. There is only one hope, and that hope is named Jesus. So Jesus is doing what He sees the Father doing, and what Jesus is doing is seeking and saving the lost. That's why He came. Jesus did not come to do all those miracles. The miracles are all a byproduct of why He came. He came to seek and save the lost. That's why when Jesus was walking in His 3-year ministry time, He was spending all of His time with who? Who was He spending His time with? The lost. Because He knew that when one sinner repented, all of heaven was rejoicing. I want you to get that image into your brain. That when someone repents and is converted to become a believer of Jesus Christ, all heaven has a party. Now, I don't know about you, but the idea of me having an impact on somebody's life, bringing them to that place that causes heaven to have a party, kind of gets me excited. In fact, I'm kind of looking forward to the point when I'm in heaven to get to be a part of that party. The very idea that something I could be involved in or something that I could be participating in that would bring another person to the point of recognizing that their sin is killing them and they need Jesus and they become converted and follow Jesus, become a believer of Jesus Christ, and all heaven has a party, just fires me up. But that's why Jesus came. Because He knew your name. He came for you. He knew your name. He knows the very hairs on your head. And he said, Kathy, I'm coming for Kathy. And on this day, Kathy's going to receive me and she's going to be a believer. And yet the whole world looks like what Paul Harvey tells us. Finally, John chapter 14, verse 12, Jesus again is speaking, "Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father." Notice the full circle here. First, Jesus leaves the Father because he's coming to do the Father's will. Now he says the people who believe in him will do the very same work that he was doing, which is what? Seeking and saving. Say that again. Seeking and saving. Now Jesus is saying all of those who believe in me will be doing the same work, which is to... You guys are not excited enough yet today. To do what? And he's saying that they will do even beyond that because I'm going where? Back to the Father. Hallelujah. Because Jesus has gone back to the Father. Now we have been equipped to do what? Seek and save the lost. And to do even greater things than that. So the circle has been completed. Now we're the hamsters who get to run in the ball. We get to be the vehicles. How do I know that? Well, turn with me to Matthew chapter 28. You're not getting my opinion today. You're getting the Bible. Somebody say amen. Bring your Bibles to church starting next week. I want to see everybody packing a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, see me after church and I will get you a Bible. Matthew chapter 28. How do we know that we're now the believers who are getting to fulfill that great idea? Jesus says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. Matthew 28, 19a. He commissioned all of his disciples to do what? Go and make, which is the same thing as to seek and save the lost. It's the same thing. It's the same idea. Mark chapter 16, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. Woo! I want you to hear the word here, believes. There is a difference between being a believer and somebody who's being a follower. I can follow all day long and never be a believer. Because a believer does what? According to Jesus, a believer does everything he has done that the Father has done. See, there's a great scripture that tells us all about followers and believers. Jesus is on a mountain. He's speaking to about 700 people. He tells them that if they're going to follow him or they're going to be believers, they have to eat his body, drink his blood, and all but 11 left. Somebody say amen. I'm telling you today, when Jesus returns, there's a lot of people who think they're followers and they're going to get left behind because they're not believers. They've simply been followers because it's easy to follow, but when I believe, something changes. I'm going to do the work of the Father. I'm going to do the work of Jesus when I'm a believer. There's a fine line that says there's a huge difference between being a believer and being a follower. Believers do the work that Jesus did, which is the work that the Father sent Jesus to do. We have now been given His commission to keep His legacy moving forward. We, the believers. If you do not believe, then you are condemned. I think there's going to be a lot of people surprised when Jesus comes back. And I think this may even be the very statement that he may, the question that may be the defining factor between a person who's actually a believer and someone who's a follower. He's going to look at you and say, what did you do that I was doing? Did you do what I did? How many people did you lead to me? How many lost people did you impact? That's why I came, to seek and save the lost. You're supposed to be doing what I was doing. Did you do that? Well, no, Jesus. You know, I was really busy. You know, I had all this stuff going on, and I was working all these hours, and you know, I just didn't have time. I want you to imagine in this moment what the look on Jesus' faces would be if that was my excuse. I didn't have time. Or I was afraid. I was afraid I might say something wrong. I was afraid I might do something wrong. So, you know, I just took my treasure and buried it in the ground and I never showed it to anybody. Or, you know, my family, they didn't like it when I was bold about Jesus. They kind of made fun of me and they laughed at me and they pointed their finger at me and kind of said some mean things to me and my family. And, you know, they weren't very nice to me because I was a believer. So I just kind of took my light, stuck it under my barrel, especially when I was around them, because I didn't want them to be upset with me. I didn't want them to be mad at me. Imagine what Jesus' face is going to look like at that moment. When he asked me, did you do what I was doing? Well, no. I kind of had a different idea about what I was supposed to be doing. I thought I was supposed to be doing this over here. I never told you to do that. That was you, all the way. You made that up. You created that. I didn't tell you to do that. That was you. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. The circle has now been fully completed because now, as believers, we have received. If you have not received the power of the Holy Spirit in your life, you will never do what Jesus has asked you to do without the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you that right now. You need the Holy Spirit poured into your life to do what He asked you to do. If your theology has kept you from receiving the baptism in the Holy Spirit, then you need to throw that theology away because it's not biblical. All believers, I want you to hear me, all believers, not followers, all believers will function with the fullness and the power of the Holy Spirit in their life. And that power will then encourage them to move forward to be witnesses and to seek and save the lost, because that's what Jesus did and that's what we're going to do. Because that's what a believer does. A believer does what Jesus did. You will never do what Jesus is asking you to do without the Holy Spirit. So I pray that today, if you have not received the baptism and the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would receive it today in Jesus' name, that the power would come down in this room just like it did in Acts chapter 1 and just 2 and just fill this room. Because that's the only way you're going to accomplish what Jesus wants you to do. You will never do it in your strength because your strength will run out. You will dry up and you will quit doing it in your own strength. That's why many people quit serving the Lord. They go for so long, but then they just quit because their flesh wears out because they've been doing it in their flesh. You can't follow Jesus in your flesh. You must follow Jesus in your spirit. I'm sorry, you can't be a believer. Forgive me for just saying that. You cannot be a believer of Jesus in your flesh. You can only be a believer of Jesus in your spirit. That's it. So what does that mean for us today? Starting today. first Sunday of 2017. You know, I look forward to these first sermons of the year every year. I love these days because every year begins a new year for us. And we have a new opportunity to change our course and to change our life. And I'm going to give you a word today that I think we, the church, need to receive. All of us need to receive for those of us who are believers in Jesus Christ, not followers, because if you're a follower, you will not receive this word. But if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you will receive this word. And Paul, well, the writer of Hebrews, most people believe it's Paul, writes to the Hebrews in Rome while he's in jail. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 11 through 14, 6 verse 1a. Most people believe Paul's writing here. There's no real proof of that. I always say Paul because I think it's Paul, but that's just me. We have much to say about this, but it's hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's Word all over again. A follower will need to have the Word taught to them over and over and over again. They will not understand. A believer will not have to have that. Someone who's only following Jesus because it looks good to follow Jesus or because I punched my ticket to heaven, that you'll have to teach him time and time and time the very simple, basic, foundational truths of Scripture over and over and over and over again because they will not understand it. But a believer, you don't have to do this. They receive it. They believe it. You, again, he's speaking to the follower, need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Therefore, and here's the word, therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity. Let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Jesus and let us move forward into maturity. Now, to move forward means that I have to get from this point and I have to take a step forward. Somebody say amen. I can't move forward staying where I am. I have to move forward. And according to the writer here, I move forward by constant use, having training myself to distinguish good and evil. Somebody say amen. How do I train myself? In the Word. If I had a quiz today, if I just started pulling people out of the crowd today and asking you questions about the Bible, how would you feel about that today? If I brought you up here today, stood you right here in front, okay, Justin, here's your question. How would you feel about that, Justin? Tell me. I can tell by the look on your face, it would not be a very comfortable thing for you, would it? Okay, so I'm not trying to pick on Justin, but I can see that Justin was uncomfortable when I even said that. I'm not trying to slam Justin. But if we are believers, we should what? Know the Word. You are not ever going to know the Word by only getting what me or any other preacher gives you on Sunday morning. You will know part of the Word that you will forget the next day after you walk out the door. You will not know the Word or train yourself to distinguish between good and evil only by what you're receiving in your cell group. You will not Train yourself to distinguish between good and evil by what you may be hearing on TV or on radio. You will only train yourselves to distinguish between good and evil when you get in the Word and you open the Word and you study and you meditate and you spend time on the Word. Not three times a week, twice a week, every day. See, because the difference between a follower and a believer is a believer will take discipline. And they will begin to apply discipline to their life. Because the words are true. I owe it all to Him. I surrender my whole life. And I owe it all to Him. So the difference between a believer and a follower is that a believer will actually grow and mature in the Lord. If you haven't growing and you're not maturing in the Lord, then I ask you, are you following or are you a believer? Are you still believing only what you believed when you first came to know Jesus? Or have you grown and matured in Jesus? See, I believe the word for us as a church for 2017 is simply maturity. Growing up. Growing up. Taking a step forward. Taking two steps, five steps, 25 steps forward in maturity. To become more mature in the Lord. And I want you to, I'm going to put to bed a myth today that I pray that you will remember this forever. It is no one else's responsibility for you to mature. It's your responsibility alone to grow up in Jesus. It is not your cellular's responsibility. It is not my responsibility. It is your responsibility. To grow up in your faith. Stop pointing the finger at someone else and getting them to do it for you. You do it for yourself. You decide that you're going to be a mature believer, not an immature follower. You decide. And you will decide by how much time you put into it. How much energy you put into it. And the fruit of that effort will be whether you will be moving forward, or whether you will be standing still, or maybe even going backwards. You decide. I don't decide that for you. Your cell leader doesn't decide that for you. The elder team doesn't decide that for you. None of the ministry leaders decide that for you. Nobody who's in leadership here in this church decides whether you're going to grow up and mature in the Lord or whether you're going to stay stagnant or whether you're going to go backwards. The only person who decides is you. Because the only person who can change you is you and Jesus. Nobody else can change you. So if you're still struggling with something you've been struggling with for 25 years, grow up. I challenge you, grow up. If you're still mad about something you've been mad about with me or somebody in the church, I challenge you, grow up. Take the responsibility for yourself. Mature in the Lord. Let the Lord do what the Lord needs to do in your life. Mature. Stop holding other people captive for it. Stop expecting other people to do it for you. Do it yourself. Get into the Word. Let the Word change you. Let the Word heal you. Let the Word transform you. Take responsibility for your life. Because that's what believers do. I've often wondered how it must have felt to Peter on the edge of that shore, and Jesus is there, and they have the conversation. Somebody say amen. See, Peter has an awesome opportunity at that moment to do what? Point the finger. Well, you know, if so-and-so would have done this and so-and-so would have done that, you know, if it had been like this or it had been like that, you know, I wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have denied you three times. Peter doesn't do that, does he? What does Peter do? He owns it. That's called repentance. When I own my life, I take hold of my life and I admit and I repent. That's the fruit of a believer, not a follower. A follower will point the finger. It's always somebody else's fault. It's always somebody else's problem. You know, if Pastor Marty would have just done this, I wouldn't have done that. Or if he'd have just done that, you know, I'd have done something completely different. Or, you know, if my cell leader, if they would have just done this, you know, it'd have been okay. I wouldn't have done it. Or what, you know, whoever it is. We are professional finger pointers in America. It's always someone else's fault. But it's not. My fault. Me. Because if I'm following Jesus, if I have met Jesus and I am a believer, then I have to function like that. Maturity, training myself, getting off of the mill, getting onto the solid food, moving forward in maturity leads us to a place of becoming a worker for Jesus, to be effective in this world. Every one of you agreed with me this morning that what we heard from Paul Harvey is an accurate picture of our world. How do we change that? One more soul. One soul at a time. One person at a time. One more soul. One life leads to two lives, leads to four lives. Leads to 8 lives, leads to 16 lives, leads to 32 lives. It's the power of multiplication. I encourage you, I implore you, I beg you to multiply yourself this year by growing up, by taking the challenge to grow up and to become a worker for Jesus, to take the commission that he received from his Father, that he fulfilled, that he then passed off to us, and make it happen. How do we know that there's still people left to be won to the Lord? I hear this all the time. Well, nobody around me really needs to know the Lord. What planet are you living on? I mean, what did Paul Harvey say? Well, that's not really in Palmyra. Really? Have you been downtown Palmyra about around 1 a.m. in the morning anytime recently? How do we know that there's still people out there who need to be won by the Lord? How do we know that this commission still applies to us today? One very simple, immutable fact. Jesus has yet to come, and until Jesus comes, this is our commission. This is what we do. Because Jesus is not coming until all who are supposed to be won have been won. So we know that the work is still here. It hasn't changed because Jesus hasn't come yet. Because when he changed, it's over. When he comes, it's all over. There is no more chances. There is no more opportunities. When Jesus returns, if he returned today and you don't know Jesus, you're in big trouble. If you're not a believer, when Jesus returns, you're in big trouble. Your following is getting you nowhere when Jesus comes. If I'm following Jesus out of convenience, or I think I've punched my ticket, you're going to be in big trouble when Jesus comes. Because the only people that will be leaving this world with him are believers. People who have done what he did. It'll only be believers, not followers. There's going to be a lot of disappointed people when Jesus comes. Because they bought into following, not believing. Now, is it a requirement for me to do what Jesus does? No. I do it because I owe all to him. I do it because I love him. Because I surrender my life to him. To use me however he wants to use me. I'm not giving myself this magic button. Oh, wow, look at this. Look at all these awesome things. Jesus is going to love me because I did all these awesome things. No, I do all these things because I love him. Because he first loved me. Because he set me free. That's why I follow. That's why I believe. That's why I do. Because he did it for me. He came to seek and to save the lost. And I was lost. That's why. I close today, and the worship team comes with simply this verse. These three verses from Matthew chapter 9, if you would turn in your Bible there. Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 to 38. I'm going to add a little bit of a twist to these today. Jesus went through all the towns of Palmyra, Hannibal, Philadelphia, Monroe City, Shelbina, Quincy, Canton, Ewing, Lewistown, LaBelle. New London, Center, Perry, Mexico. went through all the towns, teaching in their churches, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his believers, which is the same word as disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord." Who is the Lord of the harvest? The Father. See the circle? Come on, somebody say amen. I see the circle. I see the circle, Pastor Marty. I see it. I'm in it. I'm connected to it. I'm part of it. I see the circle, Pastor Marty. Ask the Father, the Lord of the harvest, therefore to send out workers into His harvest field. 2017 may be the year where you enter the field. Maybe you enter the field as a cell leader. Maybe you enter the field as a cell assistant. Maybe you enter the field in so many different ways, just serving, just doing whatever. But at least enter the field. At the very least, enter the field. Stop standing on the sidelines of the field. Enter the field. Take Jesus with you. Be His vehicle. Stop being afraid. Stop being intimidated. Stop believing all those little whispers that the enemy's trying to speak into your ear. Rebuke him in the name of Jesus Christ and cast him out, and he shall flee from you. Believe. 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 He is worthy of our belief. He will never leave us nor abandon us. He will not forsake us. He will show up if we mature, if we grow up. He will show up. He will not leave you out there by yourself. Pastor Marty, I'm scared to death. I can't. I've had all this training, but I can't be a cell leader. Yes, you can in Jesus. Pastor Marty, I know I've just wanted to go back there and teach in children's church, and I see all the needs they have there, but you know, I'm just afraid. Stop being afraid. Pastor Marty, I don't know what they're going to say about me at work if I start talking about Jesus. So what? Would you rather they be upset with you or Jesus be upset with you? Well, they might fire me. So what? Is Jesus big enough to meet your need if they fire you? Well, you know, Pastor Marty, my family, those people, they just make fun of me all the time. So what? You think Jesus wasn't made fun of? They spit on him. Over 600 soldiers spit on him. They publicly ridiculed him in front of the whole world. Stripped him down to his underwear and nailed him on a cross. In front of the whole world. Anybody done that to you lately? Get over it. Get past it. Mature. Move beyond. Move forward in Jesus in 2017. Do things in 2017 that you would never dream you could have ever done. Get over yourself and trust Him. Let him do it in you and through you. Let him make you the worker that he wants you to be. One more soul. One more soul. One more soul. I invite you to bow your heads. I invite you this morning to receive whatever it is that the God the Father is pouring into your life right now. If you are feeling the conviction of the Holy Spirit into your life right now, if you are sensing that the Holy Spirit is saying to you, wow, I need to do something different here. I need to make a change. Don't let that pass today. Make the change today. Make the change today. In your heart of hearts, make the change. Let the words of that song, I surrender my life to you, be true of you. Surrender your life today to Jesus for whatever it is he wants to do. Whatever he wants to take you, wherever he wants to go with you. Let him really be your king. Trust him. If you're in this room today and you know right now that if you were to die this week, you would be in trouble. You would not be going to heaven because you've only been following Jesus out of convenience, and you know it. You know that Jesus has just been convenient for you. You think you've punched your ticket to heaven and you're just a follower. And yet when the tough things come and the tough situation comes and the tough preaching comes and tough things from the Word come, you disappear every time. You slide away. You're not there because you can't make that choice. Understand, you need Jesus in your life. You need to accept Jesus today. You need to let him be Lord of your life. Every area of your life. You cannot follow Jesus and withhold your life from him. You cannot be a believer, a true believer, and withhold parts of your life from him. You have to give him your whole life. He will never be satisfied with part of you. He wants all of you. I invite you to respond to the Lord today as he would call you to respond. If you want prayer, if you want someone to pray with you, there's plenty of people in this room that you probably know that you could go get and have them pray with you, then you need to do that today. If you want me to pray with you or Mary and I to pray with you, we are happy to do that. You just need to come to us and we'll do that. 2017 is a big year. It's going to be a great year. Receive his blessing. Receive his encouragement and move forward. Move forward in maturity with him. Take responsibility for your life. Father God, we thank you today as we look at this teaching and we look at the scriptures and we look at these things. We see that you have clearly laid out that narrow road for us. You have laid out that narrow path that we have to get on. It truly is not a wide path to follow you, Lord. It is a narrow road, and many miss it because they're on the wide road. We pray today that you would bring us towards that narrow road, that we would focus in on that narrow road and we would follow and become a believer of you, that we would grow up. Lord, cause us to grow up in our faith. Cause us to grow up in our hearts. Cause us to grow up in our life, to mature, to move forward with you. Stop trusting this world. Stop trusting the things of this world to become a light in whatever situation we may be in. We ask for your Holy Spirit to come today and minister to each life, each heart, each spirit, each home, each family. Give us the courage, Lord, to be obedient. Lord, obedience is hard for us. Lord, give us the courage to be obedient. We love you, Jesus. We thank you.